and Tad.
Yes, Alex?
Let me tell you about Man.
Time Swap's complete failure as a Kickstarter.
Emotes go farther than words.
The first of many fuck yous. Like a fucking Looney Tunes?
The only stipulation was behave yourself and keep your dick in your pants, and you have not followed through on that.
The thing is, I actually learned a lot about economics from playing Neopets. The website went down for 3 days. Command is the first game you get to be Anthony Birch.
Ho, 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 it's Christmas time. Ho, 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 it's Christmas time.
You better watch out. You better watch out. You better watch out. You better watch out.
You better watch out. Santa's making a list. He's checking it twice. And let me tell you about, I don't know. I was going somewhere with that. I haven't seen that video in a while. I don't remember if there's more to it.
Awesome. You nailed it. Let's go.
So this is our 2016 wrap up part two, 2017. We're just going to kind of go over the whole year. This is actually a pretty fucking dece year, honestly. There's some wacky shit that went down. Some good shit that went down. Let's see, Alex, where do you think we should start? Should we jump right into the video juegos? Or should we talk about some of this other wacky shit that happened?
Well, all we play is video games. This is basically a video game podcast at this point. So let's go with the not video games part first, because I'm actually curious what happened that wasn't video game related, because I got nothing, because I have no life.
Well, I mean, so Samurai Jack came back this year.
Oh, okay. I know. I thought you meant real life shit for a minute, but you just meant other nerd shit no one cares
about.
Yeah,
no, obviously. Okay. I have no idea what the fuck happened outside.
Okay, never mind, everybody. We're both losers.
But Samurai Jack, when I was younger, I really, really, really liked Samurai Jack. I also really, really liked playing old school point and click adventure games when I was like 10. I had weird tastes.
So, like, Samurai Jack, the new season, the big finale after, like, a decade of not being on air is finally here, finally there, back in the early of the year. And it was pretty okay. My problem with it, because I gotta have a problem, is, okay, first three episodes are fucking amazing. He took it, like, this whole new direction. There was that whole entire, like, episode, I think it was episode two, where he's, like, being chased by the Daughters of Aku. Like that intense moment where he's like in the coffin and shit and that music's playing and shit. Like, he was going for this entire new way of filming, animating the show, new style, new direction, being way more serious about it because he was on Adult Swim. Then he gets Ashi and things turn into like old Samurai Jack where it starts getting comedic and shit again. They do like the fucking boner joke and stuff. And I'm like, you started off really strong and now you're kind of losing me. You know what I mean? And Ashi being, like, so super duper mega important to everything. There's a little dog going. She's so super duper mega important to everything, and she's, like, existed for only, like, three episodes.
Yeah, that felt a little bit weird to me, too. Where she shows up, and she pretty much takes over the entire season. And I kind of get why she was important, but I feel like it was something that was... I felt like this entire season, I felt like it should have been, like hour-long episodes for each one or something. Like, it felt like they had half the time to do what they actually wanted to do.
Especially the last episode had an awful fucking pacing. They were just clearly trying to wrap everything up as fast as possible. See, the reason the girl Ashi was added is actually because Samurai Jack was originally based on a fantasy Gendy fucking had when he was a kid of surviving the apocalypse with his girlfriend. So it just reminds me of that whole bit. This is why I think she was added. I think he's, like, always wanted to have that character, just never had a chance to actually put her in. So she gets in there, and, like, I'm just going to say spoilers, because fucking talking about it anyway, it fucking came out earlier this year. I hate the ending a lot, because, like, it's not the fact that the ending itself is okay. I'm okay with him, like, going back finally and being happy, even though his fucking girlfriend died. My problem with it, though, is that it just ripped off the Gurren Lagann ending.
It was
a shot-for-shot remake of it. Ted, it was literally the ending.
And it's, well, I mean, like, here's the thing, Alex. Is it a direct remake or is it an homage? Because there is a difference between them. And a remake is just the exact intention of every single thing that it just completely everything's the same. An homage is like, hey, let's I don't know. It's a fuzzy line. I feel like it was definitely I expected. I'm like, okay, final episode's coming up. Here we go. This is going to be like an hour long episode. Oh no, it's still 24 minutes. I guess they're going to kill Aku and wrap everything up in 24 minutes. Then this is probably going to feel real awkward. The ending was okay. It wasn't that bad. A bunch of people got super, super butthurt about it, but whatever.
I mean, I wasn't super butthurt. I was just like, really? I just felt like it was lame. And because, again, it's just, even if it is an homage, it's still just an ending from something completely different. Samurai Jack should have had its own fucking ending, its own conclusion. My problem with it is, like, not that it even is, like, an homage or whatever. There aren't that many, like, direct big references to, like, animes that I can remember for Samurai Jack. Maybe I was just a kid and didn't get it. But, like, I don't think you should ever end a show, even if it's not a ripoff, should end it on a reference or an homage ending that feels cheap and unoriginal and uninspired. So in my mind, even if you didn't intend to, it is just a ripoff ending.
I guess that's fair, because the conclusion to your series that's been running for like 8 years or whatever was, all right, here, it's a remake of this other anime I really, really liked. It's like, well, then that kind of cheapens the fact that you're making your own thing. And it feels
exactly
weird.
Yeah.
The biggest problem with the entire thing was, so the Scotsman shows up, he finds Aku, and he starts showing, there's a few insults. There's like maybe eight, and they're all kind of like, okay, to bad. Like, I thought, like, okay, I see what they're doing here, because the Scotsman gets crushed, comes back as a ghost. I'm like, all right, they're going to come back for the final battle, and he's going to let loose and get, like, all of these. They just left it at, like, 6 to 8 really lame insults that weren't funny. It was like, oh, okay. One thing I did like, though, is that they didn't... the thing I was worried about the most with the Samurai Jack was, I didn't want it to turn into like edgy adult cartoon shit. Like, I didn't want Samurai Jack to cut someone in half and have blood get all over the screen. Like, that's...
Well, he wasn't getting edgy like that, because like, the one time he did kill somebody that wasn't a robot, he was like fucked up and all remorseful about it, you know? Yeah. Like, they played it really well. It was really, really good at the start, and then just, I think he just ran out of ideas. I think he spent fucking 8 years thinking of that fight scene. And then when he had to write other things, he was like, ah, shit. Well, Gurren Lagann was pretty good, I guess.
Yeah, I liked it. It wasn't, it could have been way worse. It could have been way worse. So I recommend watching it. If you like Samurai Jack, you'll like the ending. Just don't be a little bitch baby about it.
Okay, let's talk about another cartoon that came out. Well, that season of a show that came out this year. Rick and Morty!
Woo! Wobble over Dub Dub! Yeah! I'm Pickle Tad! This is Pickle Podcast! Woo!
I can feel my IQ rising! I can understand every joke!
Pickle Rick!
So yeah, Rick and Morty kind of ruined a lot of things this year.
Rick and Morty ruined burping.
If my friends burps, I immediately just say, good one, Rick. I hate it so much. Like, I loved Rick and Morty. I really did. But no one made me hate Rick and Morty. It wasn't season 3. I thought season 3 was funny. I didn't even care about the people freaking out about Szechuan sauce and someone who got allegedly stabbed at a fucking McDonald's for some fucking meme sauce. I didn't care. What actually pissed me off is a thing that came out years ago during season 1. So I played Dota 2 again this year after not playing it for a while. I had the Rick and Morty announcer because I bought it back then. I found it so goddamn annoying. I hated playing a game of Dota 2 saying, oh, Wubblow Dub Dub, what's up, Morty? We're hanging out here in Dota 2. Oh, man, look at these guys running around and stuff. Isn't that weird, Morty? And Morty's like, oh, jeez, oh, man, Rick, the bot tower's under attack. Morty, bot tower's under attack. Oh, man, he picks some weird-ass-looking sea slug guy. Oh, that's weird, isn't it, Morty? Oh, yeah, jeez, Rick. I hope this doesn't get annoying. A 48-minute game of Dota, Rick. Like, it's so annoying. No one's good with the pirate announcer. When you get a double kill, he says doubloons. You know what happens with Rick and Morty? Where it's like, uh-oh, double kill. Uh-oh. And it's like, fuck off. You're so annoying. Just shut up. Rick and Morty is that annoying guy at a birthday party when you're like a kid who just won't shut up about how funny he thinks he is.
Ha ha. Yeah, I wouldn't know anyone like that. He, ha ha.
fucking fuck you. Fuck Rick and Morty right now. I am not really hyped for season 4. Because with the thing in season 3 of Rick and Morty, I think we covered this in an episode, but like I didn't like that it tried to be like a drama, which doesn't feel like Rick and Morty.
Whoever was writing the episodes was trying to make it into like fucking BoJack Horseman 2, when that is not what Rick and Morty's. It's not supposed to be BoJack Horseman. Go watch BoJack Horseman.
Rick and Morty is just supposed to be this thing that fucks around, plays with sci-fi, goes on sci-fi adventures, it ruins your expectations, and reminds you that Rick is a terrible person. You can have emotional moments in your cartoons, that's all well and good. Like, everyone remembers in season 2, when Rick did his little attempted suicide, but then passed out drunk, and like, no one came to check up on him, because deep down, no one really gives a shit about Rick. You get that whole deal, right? You get it. Rick's a sad, pathetic character.
But, and that's like, the end of it.
Yes, it's that one scene at the end of an episode. It's not every episode's going to have a 3-minute scene where we sit around discussing our emotions and problems directly to the audience rather than us just showing you as we go about our adventures. We're going to halt the episode and tell you how everything that's going on, which is why I hate that therapist scene so much. Because a therapist scene just feels like one of those YouTube videos evaluating a character, which, you know, isn't bad in itself, but you put it in the show and made me watch it rather than have me understand the character on its own. You know what I mean?
Yeah. The only good episodes of that season, it was the first episode of the season and the last episode of this season.
Yeah, because they're the only ones that were like actually just fucking around being funny. They weren't trying to be anything else. I guess I can appreciate them trying at least a little bit to be something else, but I don't like that something else that Rick and Morty tried to be, and I hope they don't ever try that again.
Kind of like South Park kind of had this too. Last season, and so 2 seasons ago, they had, I think it was season 20 with PC Principal, and every single episode was fucking gold. Every single episode was great. Then the season happened for 2016 where Mr. Garrison was the stand-in for Trump and Trump was elected, and it fucked up their entire season because they planned around, because for those of you who don't know, every 4 years, South Park does an election episode. For 2008, they had Barack Obama and John McCain, right? I think that was it.
Where
they
had an actually really good episode because they planned it with whoever won. They even say it in the episode. So one of them has to win so they could pull off the heist. Doesn't matter.
Because they were going to steal the Hope Diamond.
Yes. Fantastic episode. One of the best ones.
But for this season, they wrote it expecting Hillary to win because the whole point was the member berries. That was the big thing, was people were getting addicted to these member berries. They were getting all nostalgic and letting that take advantage of them and doing stuff like that. And then Mr. Garrison won and became president. And they're like, oh, shit. Fuck, well, we got to scrap the rest of this and start over because we did not plan for this contingency. Mm-hmm. And so the rest of the season, because if there was a documentary, I don't remember which episode it was. It might have been the Obama episode where they did a documentary about how they make a South Park episode and how they make it in like a week. They make an episode in 1 week because it's all cardboard on like a thing. And then they write it. They have like one big meeting where they write all the episodes that they want to have down. Then they just make them. They just make them in a week and it's out right then and there. But I mean, they had to throw everything out. And so the rest of the season was jokes weren't that funny. And they tried to do this weird continuity thing that kind of fell on its face. And then so this season was actually, once again, it got really good. The main plot thing across it was that Cartman got a girlfriend. Mm-hmm. And then Mr. Garrison, people were turning against him because his entire campaign goal was he's going to fuck every immigrant to death and shit like that. It was a good season. And speaking of good South Park, recently played the games. For the first time in about 7 years, I sat down and played the entirety of a game in one sitting. Well, I guess 2 sittings, because I stopped. I was like, okay, time to go do something else. Sat down on my computer. Nah, I want to go back and play. And I just turned my PS4 back on and did it again.
With this season of South Park, like, nah, it was pretty okay. There wasn't anything that really was bad other than, like, I wish it just had a better ending. Because, like, they only had a 10-episode season this year. I think they did that a little bit. And, like, it wasn't that bad because it doesn't feel like a satisfying conclusion. So before the last episode, they had this really great one where Kyle was actually turning into his mother, where they actually redid scenes from the movie from back in 2001, where it was Moms Against Canada. Now it was Millennials Against Canada that Kyle was running. And he calls up the Prime Minister of Canada, or like the Communications Administrator of Canada, who's the guy from the movie. And they have the exact same conversation that his mom had with that guy. and he yells at the president, Mr. Garrison, to wipe out this country because of the horrible things they do. And Mr. Garrison's like, oh, I got a half chub from that. Because kind of this whole fucking speech. So Trump, Garrison, nukes Canada. So Kyle just killed millions of people. And there's nothing in the next episode to, like, capitalize on that. They just kind of drop it to do a Mr. Garrison Trump approval rating joke. Make a little fun of it and Stranger Things. And then more drama with Heidi and Cartman. And Heidi breaks up with Cartman. Like, you could have had anything. The principal, PC Principal and Strong Woman joke was actually pretty funny, and I like that, but I am just biased and love PC Principal. Like,
love PC Principal.
Yeah. He became a fan favorite, like, immediately. And I'm glad, everyone was worried when he first showed up that he was going to die at the end of the season somehow or something, but he has stuck around, and I'm glad he has. He's fucking hilarious. But anyway, like, his joke with Strong Woman was actually pretty funny. I like that. I just wish that there was just, I don't know, maybe one more episode, an 11-episode season, just to actually finish it with a good thing, not just Heidi and Cartman break up, and, like, here's a bunch of jokes about Trump. That's it. They had three jokes that whole entire thing. No, two jokes. They had the fucking PC Principal and her together, and then just making fun of Trump. That's it.
What about the witch episode? I like the witch episode.
Oh, I said the season was good, just the last episode sucked.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah, like, everything else was good. Everything else was funny. I just wish they had one more episode to actually finish off the season in a better way. But definitely better than the previous one, relatively solid.
Yeah, I'm excited for the next season of South Park. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, same.
One thing I'm not looking forward to, in the slightest, I saw Star Wars Revenge of the Porgs, The Last Porg, and wow, that movie. Okay, so I guess spoilers here. Skip ahead, like, I don't know, 5 minutes? Yeah, probably 5 minutes, you'll be good. Okay, Alex, now we're going to wait 5 minutes until we actually spoil it.
Spoilers, but Snape kills Dumbledore.
Yeah, like, the new Star Wars movie, I went in there, I'm like, okay, here we go. I mean, okay, highest praise I can give it right now, I can let you know, I fell asleep during the least. This is the least Star Wars movie I've ever fallen asleep during. I fell asleep. I actually fell asleep for 15 minutes in Rogue One, and I was fading in and out during The Force Awakens. But this Star Wars movie, it wasn't a direct remake of the first Star Wars movie again, like Force Awakens was, but there was so much shit in this movie that didn't... things just happened. There wasn't really any... So the entire movie is... The rebels are being chased by a spaceship. They run away from them, stop, they catch them. They run away onto this nearby planet, they catch them. They run away again, and then they catch them, and then they run away one last time. And then someone... So the theater I saw it in, they only had reactions to two scenes. Well, three scenes. One where Luke milked the weird thing for the green milk, which was, I don't know what was going on with that fucking scene. And then the other scene was where Leia uses the Force to pull back in after being shot outside for some reason, doing like a fucking Superman Man of Steel thing. And then the third, because in every reaction that was just, what? I thought Leia wasn't a Jedi. Why could she use the Force? That one made no sense. And the last was, oh, you could just light speed through a ship? Doesn't that cause some problems? So people were just very confused about those two scenes.
See.
It was a movie. Like, if they weren't trying to pitch it as, like, this is a huge, big Star Wars movie. It's going to be bam, bam, whoa, it's going to be great. I would just be like, okay, whatever. I saw it with my cousin Joe. We watched, right before we went there, we watched Punch Drunk Love with Adam Sandler, and I had way more enjoyment watching that movie. So, not as good as Punch Drunk Love.
See, I actually like The Force Awakens because, like, to parrot Mr. Plankett, it was just basically a retelling of Episode 4, but that's fine because it's been, like, 30-something years since the original Star Wars movies, because I'm almost 40 now, so, like, you want to kind of show people who have just seen, like, the prequels what a Star Wars movie is supposed to be about and how the characters interact and shit. Right? It's more of like an apology movie almost to set things up. So it's okay in this movie, but you have to move on from that quick now that you've established it. And once I saw Rogue One, I saw it on Netflix like a year later, so no one's opinions. And surprisingly, no, I don't want to like talk about the movie, so I couldn't imagine it being very good. I just kind of figured, like, I hope this is okay. So I saw it, and like, I was just like, when they're doing like everything, it felt like a Marvel movie.
Yeah,
it felt like going through the motions, and I just said to myself, "Oh no, they have no idea what they're doing." Like, oh no, they peaked already back at Force Awakens. Like, I like the robot guy. Don't even remember his name. That's how little that character like means and everything. But he was at least kind of funny. But the thing is that he quipped so much, I'm just like, hey, look, it's Bootleg Ultron. Hey, look.
Hey, that was look, a problem the, in this hey, look, one, too.
The, we need diversity. Here's the blind Asian guy. See, he's disabled and Asian. But he was cool as fuck. To be fair, though, he was pretty cool. But, yeah. but everything about it, the fucking... I'm gonna call it the fucking Normandy Beach scene where they're fighting all the stormtroopers. And, like, everything about it just felt like the characters, the quips, the fucking settings, it just felt like a run-of-the-mill Marvel movie. And I was indifferent about it. Like, the only thing I could think of is when Darth Vader showed up wearing, like, they didn't CG him at all. They tried to be, like, hardcore and make it, like, actually his old suit, which made it look kind of weird in the modern, like, fucking setting. But they also had James Earl Jones actually voice him again. And I just thought to myself, yeah, I bet the crowd fucking started pissing their pants when they saw that.
When I saw him, I stood and clapped, Alex. No one stood and clapped in my theater, unfortunately. I was looking forward to that.
Because I don't think anybody likes this one that much, because all I've heard from everywhere, even from my normie friends and from my hardcore Star Wars fan friends, no one really likes this movie. And I hope they learn from it, so the third one's better. I'm going to go see it eventually. I just didn't have any money yet. I get paid soon. Then I'll go check it out so I can have a better opinion. But as of right now, all I can think of is just, I really, really, really hope that in the next 30 years we're dealing with Star Wars, they didn't peak at the first fucking movie.
And if you want to hear some more about Star Wars stuff, on Matt and Cody's podcast, I went on there for a fun little side thing, and we talked about Star Wars for a while. They do a sports ball podcast where they talk about baseball and maybe some other sports. I don't really know. But so that's enough about Star Wars. Let's go ahead and talk about, so for video games, 2017 actually had some pretty fucking good games. Like,
we had a lot of solid-ass games. We also had a lot of pretty bad games. Let's get right into them first and get them out of the way so the good ones seem better.
Let's start with the bad games. The games that did not turn out.
First off, the first one I can think of that came out early in the year, For Honor, because it came out in like February.
Yep, For Honor seemed like a really cool idea. Oh, sweet, here we go. But then Ubisoft kind of, Ubisoft it.
Tons of server and latency issues. Well, server, they didn't have server for the longest time. And they hyped it up as, you mean, like this very, I don't want to say realistic, but like this very in-depth fighting game with combat based heavily on real medieval like fighting moves. Like you use a fucking sword to execute somebody, you half sword them, which is like an actual technique. They use that as their example, shit like that. And when you actually play the game, it is incredibly shallow. But that wouldn't be so problem. There's nothing wrong with a shallow game as long as it's enjoyable. But the constant latency issues make it just annoying. Like, when I get hit by the assassin doing her stupid bullshit, I don't really feel like she earned it. I don't really feel like I needed to get hit. It's a salt factory.
She Hanzo scatter arrowed you.
Yeah, she's a living scatter arrow. Or, like, when I grab somebody, then the server glitches out, and then we both reset back to neutral, then he grabs me and throws me off the ledge. I just say, yeah, fuck you two.
Oh my god, I can only imagine.
Do you have any idea? Okay, I hate throws in that game, because it wouldn't be so bad. Like you could just say, well, you shouldn't stand near the ledge. That's your fault for being near there. See, that's a problem when everywhere there's a ledge. The bridge? Ledges, the neutral ground. Oh, here's a spiked barricade for no reason. Oh, the middle of the battlefield where it's a flat terrain. Here's a big pit of fire for no reason. They just throw so many hazards anyway to the point where you can't even get to a nice safe space. Not to sound like a Smash player, but fuck off. There's a limit to what I'm gonna deal with. Because there's a point where it's like, yeah, I can understand why the bridge would be out here. But then, like, the fifth map in, I'm just like, okay, fuck off. If I fall in knee-deep water and my character immediately dies, kill yourself. Because, like, you die if you touch the water in the Japanese, like, pond. But you can see the map is so, like, it's so shallow when they lay on their back, they're not even, like, underwater. They just drop down dead the minute they touch it.
Wow. Maybe it's really cold.
Oh, it still makes me mad to this day where I got thrown off that fucking bit because it fucking lagged back. I'm so mad. The way the For Honor system works is that, like, rather than make a server, it's a peer-to-peer system. If anybody, let's say you have six people, they're all connected to each other. If one person has a frame rate drop or a hiccup in his connection, all other five players will feel it at the same time.
So when you're playing For Honor and you have Juan Hernandez 2007 on your team, you're done. The game's over.
Like, the game to me, I didn't even, like, hate it when I played it. I thought it was kind of enjoyable. I just, like, it just wasn't really a game that I could see myself playing for long. I played, like, 30 hours into it, and it just didn't, like, suck me into it. There's a reason it dropped 90% of its player base in the first month, and it wasn't just those latency issues. The game just really doesn't have that much going for it. I don't really have much of a reason to keep, like, playing to earn stuff. Because majority of the things you get only matter in the weird MOBA mode, the weird MOBA King of the Hill mode with the minion dudes. Like, in a 1v1 situation, the things are pure the cosmetic, so who really cares? So, like, doesn't really matter all that much. Game's shit. The only reason I care about it nowadays is just seeing Iron Pineapple make shitty PvP videos when new characters come out. Another game that sucks. No, hang on. I'm not done because I'm still mad about things. Another game that came out that sucked. And that's all point and laugh. Lawbreakers.
Oh, no.
That game had 3,000 players at launch. That was the most it's ever had. Battleborn had three times that, Tad. Battleborn had three times the amount of players.
So
that
what the
game
fuck
was
is
dead on arrival. Lawbreakers is made by Cliffy Blazinski. Cliffy Bazooper here. It was the guy who made Gears of War. So you can already tell that this game is going to be the most uninspired piece of shit ever. And I liked Gears of War as a kid, but let's be real.
I was gonna say, like, Gears of War was pretty, it was pretty okay game. They had some neat stuff that they did that made it a fun third-person shooter.
Do you remember anything from Gears of War other than the Lancers?
Now, when you say Lancer, is that the gun?
That's the gun with the chainsaw sword.
I do remember the story, and I remember finding Dom's wife, and I do remember the reload, which was really, really fun.
That was
cover.
A good beginning.
And, like, they would throw grenades to flush you out of cover. It was
Gears of War is a game that leaves literally nothing into your brain. And I played through most of the game. I didn't play the Cole and the Cole spinoff one. Not to cut you off, but, like, I'm mad.
I will say that I played the newest one at PAX, and it was the most boring thing I've played in my entire life, though.
Because the game's never changed that much from game to game. So, like, the problem with this is that, like, Gears of War to me is super fun. It's like the pre-Marvel movie action flick. It's like, yeah, that's cool. I don't care about Joe Booper here, whoever this guy's name is. He doesn't
Booper.
Matter. The story doesn't really matter. Like, you're gonna blitz through the story, maybe have one cool scene, and then you're just immediately gonna go play multiplayer. Like, I remember the Gears of War 2 story. I remember Ty. He was cool because he was unstoppable. But then he gets stopped. They're like, man, I can't believe Ty got stopped. I thought he was unstoppable. And I'm like, this really isn't all that well written. Like, that's when I stopped caring. But, like, you go through this whole thing. You beat it. Nothing mattered. Who cares? You play the game. It's fun. I put a shitload of time into it. But, like, it's nothing to actually stick around being like, I'm not going to remember, like, yeah, Gears of War. That is a game that changed things. I don't care. It was just like a mid-2000s action game. So when the guy with the head of this, Cliff Blazinski, shows up and he's like, hey guys, I'm gonna make a hero shooter to cash in on the Overwatch and Battleborn popularity. I just think of, wow, this is gonna be shit. Much like Ukulele when they said they were gonna make the rap, I immediately lost all hope. So yeah. I didn't follow Lawbreakers that much. The only thing I could say about it is that one guy with the weird predator helmet looks kind of okay. Eh, question mark? Like, when I actually watched gameplay of this thing, the game itself has a lot of the problems Battleborn does with obnoxious characters. One of the character kill lines is hashtag you're dead, bro. Because Cliff,
why?
Because Cliffy's big, hardcore bro-down personality bled into the game. Because Cliffy, I'm going to call him Cliffy. Cliffy advertised this game being like, oh yeah, this game's hardcore. It's the bloodiest game ever. You can tell he's the Gears of War guy. It's going to be so fucking hardcore, dude. Oh, it's so badass. Oh, dude, it's so fucking cool. Also, why Gears of War still doesn't really leave that much memory. So, characters. Do you know any of the character designs in Lawbreakers?
I've seen a few of them, but it's really hard to tell the difference in a fight. Everyone kind of blends together and is all
because
muddy.
They have no. Because he never went to character design class 101. He did the mistake that a lot of people make in video games. He made a bunch of boring, normal-sized human characters who all look and shape like regular people that look the same. And they don't, but they also wear similar-shaped armor. So you couldn't even get away with making them look different silhouette-wise. They all look the same, besides the robot guy, because he's a robot, so he has robot legs. Like, that's it. And the Predator helmet guy. Kinda. Only up close, because even from far away, he still just kind of blends in with his body armor. Who cares? So, like, it's a game that, like, nobody was hyped for because they're already fatigued from Overwatch and fucking Battleborn shit. You're already in a market that has its one big dominated game. It's kind of like trying to break into the MOBA market. You're just killing yourself. Like, no one's gonna, who's gonna be playing League of Legends for 10 years is gonna say, like, oh man, Strife? Sign me up! They're gonna just keep playing fucking League of Legends.
Unless you get into a weird niche, like, and you're a big company. Like, Heroes of the Storm, Blizzard made that knowing.
Heroes
like,
of the Storm was dead for years.
Let me finish the sentence, asshole.
Never.
Blizzard was like, hey guys, let's make this a compete with Dota, because for some fucking reason why did we let this go by? Jesus Christ. Activision is going to burn down our fucking house. And then they're like, okay, we gotta make a MOBA. We gotta make one now. We gotta make it fucking right now, instantly. And we're going to make it more casual than League of Legends so we can steal their player base, because we can't compete with Dota because they make $15 million tournaments. And then eventually they were just like, oh, well, okay, no one gives a shit. You guys do whatever. Let's just work on Hearthstone. Fuck it. And so it became the fucking Smash Bros. Of MOBAs. You have motherfucking Cho'Gall. You have the Lost Vikings. There's two things the game does that I really, really, really like. One, you don't have to worry about buying items. Two, everyone levels up at about the same rate. Or I think everyone does level at the same rate. You have a team level,
and there's EXP contribution. Some characters are built around the idea of actually gaining more XP to give your team an advantage, like the Lost Vikings. There's three separate characters, so you put one in each lane so that you get three times the EXP.
Yeah. And then it's just... It's very, very similar to playing Smash Bros. With items on. You can play it, and it's pretty fun. You know, you're having fun with your cousins at Christmas, you know. But then after, like, six matches, you're like, okay, I think I've had enough. Because now, like, starting to get into the stuff where it's like, okay, I was winning. And then he got a bee drill out of Pokeball, and it knocked me off the stage. And like, okay, you know, whatever. He got a Smash Ball. He got a triple kill. That's all right. It was fun. I've had enough. You know,
Heroes of the Storm is a game that I think is fun in small bursts. I play it every now and then, but that's just because I'm a big Warcraft guy, so I just like playing as the Warcraft characters that I've, you know, seen through these games. Like, yeah. The thing with Heroes of the Storm is Heroes of the Storm was dead as fuck forever. It wasn't until the big Heroes of the Storm 2.0 update that things changed and got a little bit better, and players actually started playing it again. I think the game is okay now. But I only, like I said, only hop on it every now and then. But, yeah. So, another thing. So, yeah. Mobile industry is just dead weight to try to get into. So, that's what happened to Lawbreakers. Lawbreakers went into a genre of games that already had its big established video game that couldn't be beat, as shown with Battleborn. Even when Battleborn had, like, a decent amount of players at the start, you know, for the underground one, there's already Overwatch and then the free-to-play alternative Paladins. It's done. It's over. Leave. You're done. You can't compete now.
I mean... Because Team Fortress 2 is not a big name in the hero shooter anymore. It's not.
Well, I wouldn't even call it a hero shooter.
Yeah, I guess so. Okay, because there's not abilities.
It's more old school.
It's a Quake style game.
Yeah, there's like what Quake Heroes, Quake Arena, whatever it's called. That's like a hero shooter now. I don't know how that game's doing, and I don't care. But like, it's already established. So Lawbreakers comes in. It's like, hey guys, we have no identity, no personality. and check us out. And then no one cared, and the game just died off.
Another game that died off immediately. So me and Tim, my roommate and friend Tim, plays John Gorgrek Brick Smasher in Revival, a Dungeons & Dragons Real Play podcast. We had a lot of fun playing Chivalry Medieval Warfare. Because the first time I ever played Chivalry, I was at his house. I was in like sophomore year of high school. He's like, yo, check out this sick game, yo. Turned his hat backwards. He had like his neon. He had like that white, blue, and purple swirl. So we walk in there. I'm like, all right, cool. Okay, I'm going to choose the knight. And okay, this hammer, the maul, has the highest damage. I walk in. I go towards someone. I do a heavy. He's like, all right, you know, this is the left click. Here's how you swing. You have to use your mouse. I'm like, okay. I walk up to a fight. I do the heaviest swing possible from the side. I kill four people. I kill one enemy and three teammates. I say in all chat, I am the greatest. And then I get automatically kicked from the game for team killing. Chivalry is a really fun game. Because when Tim would play it, he would use the Zweihander. And what it is so when you swung, the hitbox was on the sword. And so people would swing and then just spaz out on the mouse. Or they would swing and then like jump, like move their heads down. Because it was all about if your sword hits someone in the head and you were just, if you were just going fast, instantly decapitated, like they're fucked, they're dead. This Zweihander, it's such huge range. And it was just really fun because you would get into melee fights. Like, you know, in Team Fortress 2, where you have 15 health and there's a pyro who has 16 health and he pulls out the motherfucking hot hand and you take out the Uber saw. There's no reason for you to do it, but you're going into that and you like dodge, duck, dip, and dive and going back and forth, going in, trying to get that quick punch off. That's what that game was.
It was literally just like source fucking melee combat. But if you're going to play a source melee combat.
Well, it wasn't source melee combat at all. It actually had like real, like your sword, it didn't shoot an invisible bullet in front of you, Alex.
When I played Chivalry 20 years ago, that's what it felt like. It just felt like dipping and diving in, trying to do melee swings at each other and shit, which is why Forerunner was a little better about that. But if you're going to play a stupid game about melee ducking and dipping and doing bullshit hitbox things, play Pirates, Vikings, and Knights 2. The superior MOBA.
But anyway, so they made a game. They shit up Chivalry hardcore by nerfing. So if you played Chivalry, if you picked up the Zweihander, it does deal a ton of damage, but it's very, very slow, but it's got a lot of range. You pick up the Maul, very, very slow, doesn't have big range, but it will fucking one-shot people, right? And then Chivalry took all of the swords and just kind of made them generic and reduced the difference between them all. So now a Maul will take two hits to kill someone, and the Zweihander will take two hits to kill someone. But it might only take one if they're already at half health. Like, they just made everything generic and not. They took away all the variety. And so they made a new game, Mirage Arcane Warfare. And what it is it's like a desert. You know, there's desert stuff, and you got magician stuff. And you got your cute, like, Chivalry, you had no abilities. You had your sword. You might have had a secondary weapon, you know, if you were someone that had that. And Mirage Arcane Warfare had some silly stuff going on. Like, you could play a fat little genie dude who could fly on a magic carpet and like shoot magic spells and stuff. But it just turned into a spam fest because it still had the melee system of Chivalry. But now you could just throw projectiles at people, when before the only people who had projectiles were archers. And archers fucking sucked. I hate archers. If you played an archer in Chivalry and you're listening to this podcast, you're not allowed to listen to it anymore. Get out. I could talk about Chivalry for hours, so. Anyway, Mirage Arcane Warfare. That game came out. It came out in, like, March. It is completely dead. It has maybe 12 people playing. The game was free for a week on Steam, and the game is still dead. No one wants to play it. Like, you fucked up. You fucked up, Torin Banner. Good job.
Oh, no, the game is just like that. There's another Lawbreakers. Was something that pissed me the fuck off. As a guy who's played a lot of Heroes of New Earth and knows S2 games, I played a little Savage. Savage is this really, really, really cool idea where it is part RTS, part third-person, like, shooter. Here's what you do. One player on your team is your commander who gives you orders, and the other, like, 10 people play as the units. So, like, you'll have your commander build bases and use, like, little NPC units to, like, build shit. You have to protect those guys. You can help build it by playing as builders. You can fucking get a gun. You can be, like, a sniper. And in Savage 2, a lot of the characters from Savage 2 were made into heroes in Heroes of New Earth. Because Heroes of New Earth is actually the third Savage game in, like, the lore. So, like, anyway. So they are like, hey, guys, what's that really cool idea, that cool game that we have? Let's make Savage Resurrection, where there was a $20 game, which was bringing it back. The old school award-winning game that people loved, that originally people even played to know the name S2. They drop it, killed it, took the money, and went back to Heroes of New Earth. It made me so angry. That game has maybe, like, three people playing it right now as we're talking. It pains me, because it's such a cool idea that just don't fucking do anything with.
That was something they were going to do in TF2 originally, in the developer commentary. They talk about one of the modes I wanted to have for the game was a commander mode, where one player would be in the base, and they would command everyone, and then the other people playing would be playing like normal TF2. But it was something that always interested me, and there was a game too. And I swear to God, this is real. No one's ever, it's either real or it's been like some imagination, like I had some kind of fever dream and pretended it was real or something. It was a game that had cross-platform play, like around the start of the PS3 Xbox time. And the PC players played like an RTS thing, but the console players would play a first-person shooter on the planet. So the PC players would be like commanding units, and they would have dominion over people on the ground. And then the people on the ground were playing on a console. Am I in fucking insane, or is this actually a thing? Because I swear to
never
God, it was
heard
real.
Of it. I think you're insane. That sounds way too like technically advanced to exist.
I swear to God, it was a thing.
Well, someone's gonna have to fact check you during the episode. But one thing I want to talk about: Neo, the Weeaboo Dark Souls.
Now, this was actually interesting to me because I'm out of Dark Souls now. I played them all. I played all the Dark Souls. I played the Bloodborne. I didn't play the DLC for Dark Souls 3, but fuck that. So whatever. I think I'm weird. I think I'm alone in this. I play Dark Souls, and my least favorite part of the game is the bosses. When I play Dark Souls, what I like to do is I like to be exploring some crazy, deepest lore. Like, deep, cool, really dangerous environment.
You're really gonna like Dragon's Dogma then, fuck.
Like, that's what I do to play a game. Like, when I played Breath of the Wild, I was walking around looking at these abandoned bones like, oh shit, some crazy stuff went down here. You know, I was walking through the, I was seeing like, oh, this is where the trading post was. This was the big, you know, this was the main building, as I can tell, because there's like 16 different bunk beds in here. There's this. I don't like fighting. The combat in Dark Souls is secondary to me. The primary reason I like Dark Souls is exploring. And so Neo seemed like it was focused more on the Dark Souls combat in smaller level-based areas, so it didn't really interest me that much.
Okay. My issue with Neo was an okay game. I didn't beat it because I didn't get too suckered into it. It didn't really pull me. Because one of the things I didn't like is that like it reuses levels a lot. Like, I've seen that one stupid mountain with the skeletons and the underground catacombs at least 4 times I'll play before I even beat it. So, like, whatever. The thing that I didn't like with Neo is I had no idea what the fuck was going on, because it doesn't explain anything to you or to the main character, William, who looks a lot like Geralt. Literally, nobody knows what's going on unless you are well-versed in Japanese history, because they pretty much do a Star... You know in Star Wars when a character comes up and everyone starts clapping? That's what Neo does with weebs and people in Japan who really like their own history. Because you'll see Mugugaki Mushibi show up, and he'll be like, hey, William from Neo, what's up? Finger gun, wink, and then walk away. And I bet Japanese people just stood up and clapped. So, like, what I fucking hate is when talking about Neo on any, like, internet board anywhere, I would say my opinion, and I would get shit on from weeaboos. And I know this, what reminded me of this is because this happened to you. When you came into my Discord with my friends, you asked, because it was in Fate, who is Oda Nobunaga? And immediately the two weeaboos, Aaron and Ryan, jump up and say, you don't know who Oda Nobunaga is? What did they teach you in school?
Not like, Japanese history.
I'm like, kill yourself. I hate you so much. I hate weeaboos. I hate so fucking much. But like, the thing with Japanese history, and one guy said this to me, and I believe it, difference between American history is like, hey, Thomas Edison made this. That's pretty cool. Next guy, you don't really care. But Japan history, you'll see Mugaki. You will I'm making up this name, by the way. They will know his fucking laundry list on January 13th of like 1469. They will know everything he did because they recorded like everything. Japanese people back then were real proud of their accomplishments and shit and would never shut up about it. So it still exists to this day and it's still taught heavily like there. So like there's a lot to like discuss. But anyway, like I hated the way it told the story. I thought it was interesting that literally every single character was a real, like, person that existed. Even the executioner guy from the very first level, that was a real guy who existed. That was a real executioner in London. Everything was based on, like, a character. But that's pretty cool, I guess. But, the gameplay didn't sucker me in, the levels didn't really sucker me in, and the game was just okay. But, fuck weebs.
There's only two more games that were bad that I can even think of that came out this year. I've got Functions versus Functions Infinite, which is Marvel versus Capcom Infinite, and that game does not seem to be doing very well.
That game died immediately. That was a Marvel game that Marvel, like, 3 lasted years, and this game is already dead. Even Chris G, the big Marvel guy of Marvel versus Capcom 3, is going back to Street Fighter for, like, full time. He doesn't want to play Infinite anymore. No one cares. No one wants it. Game looks like shit. Apparently it plays like shit. I have literally no interest in it. I don't care. Nobody cares.
I was never a big Marvel guy because when I would see Marvel
gameplay... Hopefully Dragon Ball kills it.
Yeah. When I would see Marvel gameplay, it's like, all right, there was an infinite combo that took out his health. And then, oh, he got caught in it. All right. And third character blocked it.
And
he got
it's him. Gone.
He got him in that infinite. And then his dude's gone. What I really, really like... So, Dragon Ball FighterZ, is it 2v2 or is it 3v3?
3v3, like Marvel.
Okay, so it's 3v3 just like that, but when a character dies, you both get put back on even ground in a really cool-ass transition, where like your characters come out, smash forearms, do a backflip, and get fucking ready to go. You don't get put into that, Felix Wright jumped down and immediately got beat to death, and then we go on to the next character.
It's not just a free 50-50 when you land what they're gonna do to you.
Which it might not be a 50-50. I'm sure there's more shit going on in there. But to a viewer, it looks lame as fuck. I mean, fuck it. You know, get it out of here. The only other game that I really want to complain about is Nidhogg 2, and man, you fucked up on that art style. Nidhogg 1, it was an Atari-style thing. It had that Atari kind of graphics. Nidhogg is a very, very simple game. You move with the control stick. You can tap up on the... You're holding out your lance. You're holding out your little pointy thingy. Your little fucking... What's the fucking sword, Alex?
What, a rapier?
Yeah, you're holding out your rapier, right? And you can press... You know, you got three... You got high, medium, and low. And then you can... I think you can press a button to... You can press one button to jump and one button to stab forward. Or maybe you can't even stab. I don't remember. It's actually been a little while since I played. But that's it. And then you move left and right. One of you has to get past four screens to the left or four screens to the right. That's all it is. It's just real simple. It gets crazy because you can, like, jump kick people. You can stab them with your sword. It's just goofy. There you go. It's really fun. So Nidhogg 2, they're like, hey, we're introducing new weapons and stuff. I'm like, oh, this sounds like it'll be a lot of fun. And then the art style they chose looks very ugly. They chose, like, this, it pops out, like, okay. You know in Rayman, there is that mosquito guy with the giant eyes?
Yes.
Give him a body.
I've seen it. The game looks like shit.
I feel bad because I was really interested in this game, but I'm like, this looks so ugly that I'm still interested in the gameplay, but I am much, much less... Presentation does matter in a video game. There are people who say, like, oh, I don't care about graphics at all. Like, it does matter. Like, even if that's not, you know, I'll play a text-based adventure game that has literally no graphics, you know? That doesn't matter, you know? I'll play an ugly-as-fuck game. Like, I'll play an old-ass N64 game that looks like shit. But if it's just if it just has an ugly art style that's distasteful and gross... It's going to take a lot to get me to finish that game. Like, the gameplay's got to look real, real chick, you know?
Exactly.
So those are all the shit piles that happened this year.
Well, that took 51 minutes.
Yeah, because you kept talking about dumb shit, Alex. It's all your fault. Oh, you're the last thing that was shit this year.
Well, there's one thing that was shit this year. I'm going to say it. Tad, Cuphead is the boyhood of video games.
No, okay, Alex, you're wrong.
I had to get this opinion out in this video.
Okay, so Alex has terrible opinions, right? Everyone knows this.
I'm completely in the right with what I say, and you know it. You fucking know it. Okay, here's the thing with Cuphead. I've said it before. I don't hate the game of Cuphead. It's okay. It's fine. I don't even care. I legitimately am just going to sound like a fucking hipster. I'm going to sound like one of my fucking idiot friends. I hate how popular it is when the game itself doesn't seem like it warrants it. And the first thing I thought of was Red Letter Media's video of Boyhood, where no one talks about how Boyhood actually, like, was, what the movie was about or anything. They just go, Boyhood? That movie took 12 years to make! Oh, I love Boyhood! Oh, dude, it won every award! Oh, Boyhood's so great!
Did you know it took 12 years to make?
When I think of Cuphead, I just think of, wow, Cuphead? That game took forever to make! Oh, that game is a 1930s art style! What? 1930s art style? Oh, I love Cuphead!
See, here's the thing, though. That art style, they implemented it very, very well. Bosses have... The only thing that I can really complain about with Cuphead is that bosses don't... When you beat a boss, it just kind of ends. They don't have, like, a pow, an explosion thing or anything like that. But they're all hand-drawn, which is very, very hard to do. It looks really good because they spent most of that time balancing out bosses to be fun and making sure that everything looks really, really, really good. You can't hold the idea of, like, oh, well, they spent all this time making the art style. Who cares about art? You just take a pencil and you put it on paper and you go, eh.
See, I didn't real say easy. That, but what I mean is, like, the game itself is just okay, and it's winning everything just because it looks pretty. That doesn't feel right. It doesn't feel fair.
It's not just because it looks pretty.
It's just because it looks pretty, Tan. You goddamn know it.
No, it's because the game is fun. I'm sorry, Alex. Oh, yeah. You're going to pull out the fact that you beat it with 100 less deaths than me because you would 200. Reset when you got hit? Like, oh, I got hit, time to reset because you're a little fucking bitch.
Clearly, I just played the game too well. We're going to do this probably for the next few months, the next, like, year. But anyway, it's the boyhood of video games, and fuck the people that like it way too much. Doesn't deserve it.
Whatever. It's a perfectly fine game. I'm happy it got what it got. Okay.
So now that we've talked about everything we hated this year, let's talk about the few things, because they ain't going to last long, that we liked in 2017.
So I really, really liked Hat in Time. That came out. It's the N64 style, GameCube style platform I've been looking to play for a really, really long time. Glad I played it. Really fun game. Sonic Mania. That game's pretty fucking slick. That game was good. A lot better than Sonic Forces.
I wanted to play Sonic Forces just so we could do an episode on it, but I never had the money to get it, and I can't really convince myself to get it.
There was another game that came out this year that I really, really enjoyed. I don't know if anyone can guess what it is. The answer is Styx 2, Shards of Darkness. Styx is a very fun game. It is a vertical stealth game where you play as a goblin. It's by the people who made Of Orcs and Men, which is apparently a really good game, but the gameplay sucks ass. So it's like one of them story-based games. Every day it's on sale for like $6.
Okay, the games that I really, really liked this year, I really like Persona 5. Loved it. Hollow Knight, which I never shut up about. Fucking amazing game. I actually really enjoyed ARMS, but ARMS only really, really got, like, good. Like, I would say, like, yeah, ARMS is fun, but I wouldn't recommend it until the little pop-up date came out that added, like, the badges and shit and all this other stuff to make getting money way easier and less, like, horribly grindy. So, like now, I highly recommend the game. It's a lot of fun if you have a Switch. Splatoon 2 came out and was pretty goddamn good. So I didn't put nearly as much hours into Splatoon 2 as I did Splatoon 1, just because, like, you know, I already played Splatoon 1 a lot. Don't really need to play that much of Splatoon 2. I get it. Another game that came out this year that I really, really liked was actually Fate Extella, because I'm getting into Fate this year. Got super into Fate, as anyone in the Discord would have fucking noticed. And, of course, I gotta say it, because both me and Ted are gonna love it, Super Mario Odyssey. Oh, wait, he doesn't have a Switch, so he didn't play it. Everyone point and laugh at him.
It's not my fault, Alex.
Ha 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 ha.
I literally could not find one, but I did spend almost $300 just to play Breath of the Wild, though.
Yeah, he played it on Wii U.
I bought a Wii U just to play Breath of the Wild.
There's other good Wii U games you should try out, like Wonderful 101.
I'll actually get around to Warriors. That.
I highly recommend Wonderful. Wonderful 101 is a game that everyone says, oh, it's so good, ooh, but they never played it. Much like Cuphead.
Shut the fuck up, Alex.
So, but unlike Cuphead, Wonderful 101 is actually fun. It has a lot of really nice things in it. You should give it a shot. So. Now we're going to say it. What was your game of the year of 2017?
This is easy. And honestly, if you don't answer the same one, Alex, I'm going to be very confused. Breath of the Wild.
Ooh, that's a good one. I understand that.
Breath of the Wild is... Not even kidding. It is a game that came out this year that has a very firm place. I was going to say a place in my top five. I would put it in my top three favorite games I've ever played in my entire life. Ooh. That game hit every single thing that I have ever wanted in a video game. Literally, there's only two complaints I have about Breath of the Wild. Enemy variety and the fact that I can't sit down on a grassy knoll and cast a fishing line in there and fish like normal. I have to do redneck fishing with a bomb. That was disappointing. Those are the only two fucking complaints I have about that game. Oh, and I guess there weren't caves. I don't know why there weren't a lot of caves. That seems like something that should have been obvious. But that's it. Like, that's it.
There was like one cave and it was with the Yiga Clan's cave.
Yeah, I played that game for 7.5 hours every single day until I beat it at like 150 hours or something.
See, I put like 70 hours into that game, apparently, according to my Switch.
I would wake up, go home, or I would wake up, go to work, and while I was at work, I would be thinking to myself, okay, when I get home, I'm going to have to gather some chili peppers, I'm going to have to get some meat, I'm going to have to make some of the heat potions so I can go up on Mount Lanayru and see what's up there. Because last time I was there, I saw this thing there, I got to prepare, I got to, okay, where can I find this? How can I plan my way down? How can I make sure I got this here? Okay, I got to manage my weapons. Like, I was planning out my route to climb this fucking mountain and shit. That's how deep I got it. Yeah, I get so deep into that game. I went outside, saw a pile of leaves, and for a split second, thought, there's a Korok in there. So maybe I got a little too deep into it.
Okay, so Breath of the Wild was super, super good. But, not my game of the year. I was thinking about this for a while. There are a couple of contenders. It would have either been Breath of the Wild, Hollow Knight, or Super Mario Odyssey. I wouldn't count Persona 5, because even though Persona 5 came out for us in 2017, technically in Japan it came out in 2016, so it would be like a cheap shot, you know? So, I thought about this long and hard. Breath of the Wild was really, I guess, innovative would be the right word to say, of how you think of like Zelda games, completely new. But the things that I think held it back were all the Korok seeds. And when you get right down to it, when you're traveling from place to place, while the world is really pretty and it's fun climbing over everything, all you find are Korok seeds and, like, an enemy camp that doesn't have anything really in it, other than, like, another Bokoblin shield that I don't need. So, the way I see it, the game is stellar and a 9 out of 10, but not the best game for me. I'm gonna say it. After its update, it's Hollow Knight. Hollow Knight's my game of the year.
Really? I mean, yes. No, I get it. Hollow Knight was a very, very fun game.
What I like about Hollow Knight, maybe I'm just biased because it was an indie game, as opposed to something like Breath of the Wild or Super Mario Odyssey, but with Hollow Knight, it is, it looks absolutely beautiful, has a great art style, but unlike Cuphead, it isn't the only thing it's got going for it. Maybe I just like the Metroidvania game style a little bit. Maybe I'm just a little more biased towards something like that compared to Cuphead. But I absolutely loved the way the world looked, the way the world felt, the way you moved around in the game, the way the characters spoke with their gibberish language. We talked about this in the Hollow Knight episode. Like, I'll just be repeating myself. I loved pretty much every single aspect of that game. And that's the way I thought of it. There wasn't a single thing in Hollow Knight that I actually disliked. Yeah. See, with Breath of the Wild, there were those two things I didn't. Super Mario Odyssey, that one was the tough one, because I didn't actually dislike anything Super Mario Odyssey. I had to think really hard, was there anything I didn't like in Mario Odyssey? The only thing I would say I didn't like in Odyssey is that the music was only okay. There's a bunch of stellar tracks that stand out, like Jump Up Superstar, The Honey Loot Escape, blah blah blah, and Steam Gardens. But then that's kind of all you have. Like, what was Lake Kingdom's theme? I don't know. What was Ocean Kingdom's theme? I don't know. What was the Candy Kingdom? I don't remember any of the music other than Steam Garden and the two ones with lyrics. Like, that's it. Didn't stand out to me. And then I realized there's the one flaw. So the only game that I had no problems with, no issues, no flaws with at all, was Hollow Knight. Because I loved the style, the playing, the world, the music, everything about it. Yeah. That's the way I thought of it.
I would definitely number games. Two. Number two rank would have been Hollow Knight there. But Breath of the Wild was just so good that it had to be number one. Like,
that's a fair thing. That's fair.
Yeah, but let's go into the most important one. Favorite meme of 2017.
Oh boy, we're really fucking funny now. Okay, so
the virgin game of the year and the Chad meme.
Yeah, that's pretty much it. Everything in 2017, fucking like internet humor wise, was pretty goddamn shit. I hated Omoe wa Shinderu. I was so loud and annoying. As one guy said, it's the I'm a fire in my laser of 2017.
Ooh.
I hated the Crash meme. All of my friends loved Crash.
Okay, are you talking about... The whoa!
Whoa, yes.
Okay, that one was lame. Alex, the Crash Bandicoot as Dark Souls meme was pretty fucking good.
Oh, no, that's fine. That's okay. Yeah, that one's okay. That's funny because that's shitting on stupid people comparing games to everything. Yes, that was completely okay. It's specifically the Oni plays whoa thing that gets posted all the time. My friends would post like remixes and shit of that video all the time in like fucking SyncTube, and I would just be like, so unhappy. I would just leave. I'd honestly just leave. I didn't want to fucking watch it. It's so lame. I don't care. It's not funny. But I don't care. It's not funny. Don't talk. But the actual greatest thing of this fucking year was the Virgin and Chad meme. That meme alone revived fan interest in Xavier, Renegade Angel.
Yep, that's why it's my favorite, was it brought people back to Xavier just because... I'm pretty sure it was just because of that image comparing Xavier and Rick and Morty, where people remembered Xavier existed.
Yeah, like, you have to remember, all it takes is one guy to say something stupid for everyone to start, like, giving a shit. Remember in ye olden days, in like the 14 or 1500s, when that guy said, this is bullshit, the church is bullshit, here's 95 reasons why, he broke 1,000 years of tradition by just shitting on the church. Like, all it takes is one guy to start shitting on something and everyone will start talking about it. The Virgin and Chad meme, the way I see it is a wholesome meme of nothing but good qualities. It is not loud and obnoxious in your face. It creates creativity, and it's based on a very old joke of just comparison. It's really easy to mock something based on, oh, this is lame, but this is cool. And it's just that. And it's just perfectly great. It's kind of like how last year we had We Are Number One, which could be considered annoying to some people, but I consider it wholesome because it was very creative and it saved a man. It cured cancer.
Well, it didn't cure it. It put it in remission, young man.
No, but if I say it like that, people... That's my clickbait title for it, though, Tad. Meme saves man. Meme cures cancer. Anyway. But yeah, the Virgin Chad meme, fucking hilarious. Absolutely loved it.
It's a good comparison of... The Virgin X is usually just... This is something that people normally
this
do.
This is something I don't like, versus this is the thing that I think is cool.
And then you make it into a hyperbole. Like, the Virgin walk is where someone just kind of walks. The Chad stride where you whip your legs out, you hit everything around you.
Or the Chad, like, the Virgin shit, sits with his legs closed together, barely squeaks out one turd. The Chad quake, he's shitting over the toilet for maximum efficiency and shits out literal mountains.
It's just dumb stuff like that. It was good, funny joke jokes.
Okay, now I have to say this. As a guy who goes to V all the fucking time, I just said my favorite post of 2017, whether it be from some shitty place like 4chan, Reddit, or Tumblr, my favorite post of 2017 was in an Assassin's Creed Origins thread. So 75% of the players voted they're not excited for the new Assassin's Creed. Everyone just wanted to shit on it. It was really easy. So I go in there because I'm like, I want to see this. There was this one guy just complaining immensely about black people. This guy, someone hurt him when he was a kid. He just went on and on. It was this paragraph upon paragraph, like a novel he wrote about black people and how they're a plague upon society. All this shit that you could totally cut out my audio out of and put it out of context and make me sound bad. And then nobody replied except for one guy One guy replied with a picture of Skeet from Jimmy Neutron saying, Big McThankies from McSpankies. He gave so little of a shit about what this guy had to say about his opinion of the world, his view of the world, that he reduced everything he said to a shitty line from Jimmy Neutron.
Big McThankies from McSpank. How do you, what are you supposed to do? Are you supposed to respond to that and be mad? Like, no, your opinion was so shit, I'm not going to even type out a response. I'm just going to respond with the, like, with the equivalent of a Pickle Rick from 10 years ago.
So, anything else in 2017 you want to discuss, Tad?
I'm glad it's over. 2018, I don't know, it should be pretty neat. We'll see what happens. I don't know if there's any big games coming up for 2018. La Mulana 2 is most likely going to come out in 2018. Been really excited for that.
Well, hey, aren't you excited for Persona 3 and Persona 5 Dancing All Night?
Oh, I am. Can't you tell from my voice I'm real fucking excited about those games, Alex? La Mulana 2, there's a Yoshi game and a Kirby game coming out, that Pokemon Switch game. The new God of War, I want that to be good, and I don't want it to just be a ripoff of The Last of Us. Last of Us 2 does not look like it will be good. Hopefully I'm wrong, because I really, really, really fucking enjoyed The Last of Us. What other games? Dragon Ball FighterZ should be pretty fun. I heard that Goku Monster might Hunter confirm Worlds. For that game. Monster Hunter,
Well, I like Monster Hunter. I'm going to do a whole episode on it one day. But I think Monster Hunter is a very shining gem, jewel, whatever, in this sea of shit fucking PvP-only MOBA-inspired bullshit shooters and shit. Or just straight up MOBAs and shit. It is a game of just working together, no PvP bullshit at all, just working together, killing monsters that aren't controlled by players, like Evolve, where you can get pissed off about people doing some bullshit. Just four people hanging out, doing shitty emotes to each other, using stupid weapons, big, stupid, cartoony weapons, beating down big, stupid, sunny monsters with a bit with caveman names, and then getting more gear to fight more monsters. It is wholesome, as the Christian gamers would rate it. Which is why I'm excited for it.
But yeah, 2018's got a few crazy things coming up. I don't know what movies are coming out. Probably some dumb ones. There might be a good movie, though.
Well, it's going to be another Star Wars movie, because it's going to do one every year. One main one, then a spinoff, then a main one, then a spinoff, then a spinoff.
My favorite. That there's a Strong Bad reference. What I'm excited for in 2018, thing I'm most excited for, the Strong Bad April Fool's Homestar Runner update. That's what I'm looking forward to. That's all I got coming up in 2018. I guess that'll go ahead and that'll do it. You can find the podcast here on YouTube, iTunes, and Google Play. You can find links to all of those in the description or on the website, lmtya.com. You can send letters on into the show via the Twitter at letmetellyoupd, or the Discord, or through the email, which is letmetellyouabout@gmail.com. Let me tell you about with three T's. Like I said a little bit ago, you can find us on the Discord. There's also a Patreon that we have set up, and every month we do the questions of the month. December's, we got some real interesting questions in there. So that'll be coming up around the end of this month, start of January. There's still a little bit of time to get those in there if you're a $2 and up backer. But yep, that'll do it. And remember, Alex, I hate you.
You too.
And I hate Homestuck because I forgot that goes first.
You too.